Everyone, thank you for coming out this evening. I'm Kyle Cleveland. I'm the Associate Director of the Institute of Contemporary Asian Studies. And I'd like to welcome all of our speakers and thank Tina Saunders, who has really worked so hard on putting this series together. This series is a set of three conjoined panels. The first one that we had on February 23rd was on racial profiling under the color of law, this one dealing with Muslim and religious surveillance and profiling in Japan. And then the last one on April 5th will be on political dissent and protest. They're all thematically conjoined, and you know, it's kind of ironic and funny that when Tina and I had started talking about this, we probably imagined that there would be slightly a different world order than what we have found ourselves in the middle of now. And these issues have become tragically all the more relevant today as profiling has basically become state policy in the United States, and we see the implications with that and the effect that that's having on minorities and the law and the relations with among the political parties. America's at a really remarkable historical moment, and I think a lot of that is infused with anxiety, nationalism, racism, and those are all really contrary to the fundamental principles of democracy. So in making a cross-cultural comparison to Japan, we all know that being a foreigner in Japan has some privileges, but also Japan does have racial profiling, and that is something that's part of state and immigration policy. And since 2001, we've seen that this has become state policy not only in the United States, but in Japan, as they scrutinize and surveil minorities, particularly people who have Muslim faith. I think as we move towards the 2020 Olympics, we're going to see even more of this, in which there may be a more aggressive police presence in Japan, and the impact that that will have on minorities is really, really worrisome. Temple University is a very diverse college. We're based in Pennsylvania. We're one of the largest state universities, have about 39,000 students in Philly. A few years ago, U.S. News and World Report Education Report had cited Temple University as the second most diverse university in the United States. Here at TUJ, we have students from 52 countries. And, you know, I had a class, I was telling someone about this earlier, that I had gone on a field trip with a group of students. I took a photograph. There were 17 students in the photograph, and there were students from 12 countries in that one photograph. And that was students who had randomly come from different classes. So that's one of the great things about Temple University, that we have that kind of diversity and that we do have those as some of our core values. And I'm really glad that the law program has worked on this to see how this is embodied in the law. And this evening, the panel that we have are really practicing authorities on this that have done really important work on this. So I'll let Tina introduce the speakers and we'll move forward from that. Later, we're going to allow time for a very open Q&A, and we encourage you to come forward with your questions. So I'd like to introduce Tina Saunders, who's the director of TUJ's Law Program.
Thank you very much, Kyle, for the kind introduction. On behalf of the Law Program and ICAS, the Institute of Contemporary Asian Studies, we want to give you a warm and open welcome to our second lecture. We're quite proud of this lecture series because it's generated such interest here in Japan. And the issues that we are dealing with now, they are not just issues that are confined to the United States, but these are global issues, these are human rights issues, and they demand and deserve the attention. So through this lecture series, we are working to at least inform and to provide a forum for you to express your ideas, to ask questions, and to learn more about some of the policies and practices of the government, as well as the legal instruments that are being employed here and in Japan. So I'm going to briefly introduce our speakers tonight. Leading our discussion and as our moderator is Professor Masaki Kakizaki. He is an assistant professor of political science here at Temple Japan. He focuses his research on Middle Eastern politics with an emphasis on party politics within Turkey. And to my left, his right, or his left as well, actually. So, his left is Professor Sebastian Maslow. Professor Maslow is an assistant professor of political science at the Graduate School of Law at Tohoku University. We are quite privileged and honored to have Professor Maslow join us this evening. He focuses his research on Japan's national and foreign national security policies. He is a regular commentator on these issues and will greatly benefit from his expertise. Ms. Junko Hayashi, she is a Japanese attorney and she's a member of the Tokyo Bar Association. Ms. Hayashi is such a fantastic lawyer and I've had such a great privilege to get to know her over the past maybe 2 months or so. And she is a part of the legal team that helped to file a lawsuit here in Tokyo challenging the surveillance program of Muslims here in Japan. So she will lend her expertise and explain the civil litigation that occurred here in Japan related to the topic. And last but not least, we have Professor of Law Lawrence Repeta. Professor Repeta is a professor of law at Meiji University. He also is a scholar on the Japanese Constitution, as well as focusing his current research on the civil litigation that's occurring in the United States related to the United States surveillance program targeting Muslims. So as you can see, we have quite an illustrious panel of experts that I think will provide a lot of information and will encourage a lot of good discussion among all of us. So with that, I will turn it over to Professor Kakizaki.
Good evening. Tina, thank you very much for your very kind introduction. Kyle, also for your kind words, and thank you for having me here today. It's a great privilege to speak here at Temple University. It's my first time indeed. So, as we have legal experts here on the panel, and I'm the only political scientist beside the moderator, I'll try to keep myself as brief as possible to give the experts on this issue more room for elaborating on this issue. The assigned task that I have today is to provide you with a background on the issue of Muslim surveillance, counterterrorism in Japan as it has evolved after 9/11 in particular. So I will give you an outline of Japan's response to 9/11, Japan's counterterrorist policies throughout the last decade or so. I'll try to keep to my notes in order to stick to the 50 minutes that I've been assigned. The tensions or the trade-off between national security and civil liberties is a recurrent theme in public and academic discourses, I'm sure you all know. New anti-terrorist measures introduced in the aftermath of 9/11 and the global war on terror have amplified this tension. Writing in 2003, on the diverse response to 9/11 in the US, Germany, and Japan, the German-American political scientist teaching at Cornell University, Peter Katzenstein, has identified three different discourses on counterterrorism. While in the US, 9/11 was primarily seen as an act of war, Germany has considered the attack a crime, while Japan perceived it in terms of a crisis. Each discourse produced a different policy response. The US proclaimed a global war on terror, Germany revised its national legislation on combating terrorist crimes, and Japan responded by expanding its military role in international security and revised its national security institutions. However, in all three countries, governments have shifted towards emphasizing security over civil liberty through governing the population via politics of fear. The 2001 USA Patriot Act and its 2006 revision have restricted civil liberties through extensive surveillance and financial counterterrorism. Other governments followed swift. For example, in light of its role in the 9/11 terrorist attacks, Germany has implemented broad counterterrorist measures in 2001, including legislation on the association of religious groups and the granting of access to telephone, banking, employment, and university records to police authorities. In addition, Germany has expanded computer-based data mining techniques. In German, it's called Rasterfahndung, to store personal data and conduct detailed searches of data from 8 million individuals. However, as this measure failed to generate any evidence for counter-terrorist purpose, the German Constitutional Court restricted this technique to its use in situations of imminent and concrete danger, arguing that this measure in particular violated the presumption of innocence. Japan's response to terrorism largely followed the post-9/11 global trend of expanding executive authority in combating terrorism. Thus, reports by the Japanese media in October 2010 on a mass surveillance program came as no surprise in terms of post-11 counterterrorism. Yet, the measures imposed by Japan were not a response to concrete terrorist threats, but an inflated terrorist threat in order to broaden the state's police capabilities and to push for an active role in international security. Following 9/11, Japan immediately pledged support to its US ally. New legislation allowed Japan to dispatch its troops in support of the international campaign in Afghanistan as well as the war in Iraq. Simultaneously, Japan responded by pushing for institutional change of its internal security. As calls for stricter anti-terror and profiling measures grew louder, the administration of Koizumi Junichiro established the third Foreign Affairs Division, or in Japanese, the Gaiji Daisanka, within the Public Security Bureau of the Tokyo Metropolitan Police Department in October 2002. As Japan's first organization on focusing on international terrorism, this new division was specifically introduced for the purpose of gathering intelligence on foreign residents with links to Islamist organizations. These changes were legitimized by discourses emphasizing an imminent terrorist threat to Japan's society and Japanese overseas. And yet, no reference was made to Japan's role in international security operations, such as Afghanistan and Iraq, as causes for enhanced exposure to terrorist threats. In contrast, Japanese victims of Islamist terror during the 2000s were confronted by discourses on self-responsibility at home with little emphasis of the state's role in protecting the lives of its citizens. Meanwhile, Japan was no stranger to the threat of terrorism. In light of Asia's Cold War, the Japanese state saw in the mobilization of the political left since the 1950s its main security challenge. Under the Anti-Subversive Activities Law of 1952, Japan's newly established Public Security Investigation Agency was empowered to conduct long-term surveillance of subversive organizations, that is primarily left-wing organizations. In line with Japan's conservative policy, the police law was also revised in 1954, assigning the central government full control over the security police, its personal affairs, and budget. In the following decades, Japan's response to terrorism was primarily shaped by its struggle with radical left-wing terrorism as it emerged in the late 1960s, most prominently in form of the Japanese Red Army. So the state's focus on leftist terror continued until the mid-1990s and was only disrupted by the rise of radical religious terror in form of the sarin gas attack by Aum Shinrikyo in 1995. As the threat posed by leftist terror diminished in the 1990s, the global war on terror offered a new opportunity to direct and expand the architecture of Japan's security police. Despite concrete evidence of an Islamist threat to Japanese security, or the event of an actual Islamist attack within Japan, the Japanese public considered Islamist terror the most important security concern in the early 2000s. To facilitate the terror narrative, policymakers have framed North Korea, in addition, as a terrorist state since 2002, which also helped to redirect Japan's focus towards international terrorism in general. So while many aspects of Japan's internal security apparatus remain opaque, reports suggest that the new counterterrorism unit created in 2002 was initially composed of a staff of 70 and during later stages expanded to 150. At the time of its installment, this new unit indicated a shift in the focus of Japan's internal security apparatus. The surveillance program reached its full operational stage in June 2008 in the preparation of Japan's hosting of the G8 summit in Hokkaido. For this purpose, and I'm sure Hayashi-sensei will elaborate on this in more detail, 43 agents of this newly established unit were mobilized for 24-hour surveillance of mosques and other relevant institutions in Tokyo. Reports, however, suggest that the entire surveillance program installed by the Koizumi government required the work of an entire personnel of about 218 agents. So what's important here, in addition, is that the leak that Hayashi-sensei will, I think, later describe in more detail, the leak of 2010 was composed of 114 files and approximately 1,000 pages of documents. And this leak was traced to the 3rd Foreign Affairs Division of the Tokyo Metropolitan Police Department's Public Security Bureau. The leak revealed an extensive and systematic surveillance and profiling scheme specifically designed to target Japan's Muslim community in the Tokyo area. The program has generated a database profiling more than 72,000 residents in Tokyo, that is approximately 90% of its entire Muslim population in the Kanto area. So violating civil liberties of privacy and religious freedom, the case triggered a series of lawsuits ending with a Supreme Court statement as of May 2016, which confirmed the constitutionality of Japan's surveillance program and therefore the state's priority on national security over civil liberties. Important to note in this regard, however, is that the data leak gained attention in Japan as a problem of information and security control and not a human rights issue per se. So this suggests that the sustained effect of the entrenched terrorist threat narrative as it evolved in post-war Japan has gained significant influence on its policy. Since 2013, the current administration of Abe Shinzo has continued Japan's efforts to expand the state's power in counterterrorism. The push was enforced by a series of terrorist attacks involving Japanese citizens, starting with the Algerian hostage crisis in January 2013. These events have spurred debate on new crisis management capabilities, intelligence sharing, and the use of military force abroad. As a result of this debate, Japan established a National Security Council and introduced the new state secrecy law in late 2013. Again, the killing of Japanese citizens by ISIS in February 2015 in Syria and in July 2016 in Dhaka, Bangladesh, illustrated Japan's exposure to global terrorism as the Abe administration seeks an active role in international security. In May 2015, the Abe administration, in light of the G7 summit and the upcoming Olympics, established a special task force within the Prime Minister's office, and which is headed by the Chief Cabinet Secretary Suga Yoshihide. The International Terrorism Intelligence Gathering Unit, as it's called, is based within the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and composed by staff from MOFA, Japan's Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and the Cabinet Intelligence Research Office. This new unit is composed of a staff of 20, which is interesting because if you compare this staff allocated to terrorism, Japan's newly established procurement facility for weapons within the Ministry of Defense is composed of a staff of 1,800, which illustrates the importance that the Abe government assigns to terrorism with regard to arms exports, for example. So the latest step in Japan's push for expanding executive power in its quest for national security is the Abe administration's attempt to revise Japan's organized crime law. While such laws were repeatedly introduced and repealed during the early 2000s, this time the Abe government has framed the new bill as a specific measure to counter cross-border terrorism and the need for Japan to tighten security as a host of the 2020 Olympics. However, with ambiguous explanations of potential targets of this law, fears of a further infringement of individual rights emerge in Japan. Yet the broad state surveillance enabled by the by this initiative indicates a larger trend of expanded state authority that unfolded with the surveillance scheme that was uncovered in 2010 and which is described in more detail by Hayashi Sensei and Professor Repeta. So to sum up, the bottom line of my argument here is to use a political science concept, post 9/11 governments have securitized and inflated terrorist threats in a push for promoting state authority and thus to emphasize national security over civil liberty. Japan has used the narrative of a global terrorist threat to redirect and expand police authority domestically and the military role internationally. The surveillance program indicates that the balance in the debate on security versus civil liberty has shifted significantly towards the former, that is, national security. Large sections of Japan's society, universities, the corporate sector, have accepted the new threat narrative while willingly collaborating with the state in implementing surveillance schemes. Absence of a broad and critical media focusing on the surveillance program and other counter-terrorist measures in Japan has further removed a check on the state's pursuit of expanding its authority vis-a-vis its citizens.
Thank you very much. Okay, so I think Professor Maslow here nicely established the link between this particular surveillance program on the Muslim community in Tokyo and changes in world affairs and local politics in Japan since 2001. And I have several questions for Professor Maslow, but I think we should listen to other panelists first, and then I'm going to put those questions on the floor. So next, Hayashi-san. The floor is yours.
Hello. Thank you for having me here today. Honestly, I'm really nervous now, so please excuse my English and the mistakes that I'll probably make. So, like Tina explained, I am one of the members of the legal team that challenged the surveillance of Muslims in Japan. And before I start explaining about the lawsuit, I would like to explain about what happened, actually, like, you know, before we filed the lawsuit. Professor Maslow explained, in 2010, October 28th, that some information leaked on the internet from the Metropolitan Police Department's security division. And it was clear that it came from the police. And it was everybody could tell it was from the police, you know, from the information that was on the, what kind of information they had. And there were so many people downloaded it in a very short time. But a publisher in Tokyo actually tried to publish a book out of the information, and I got one copy here, which we actually got injunction, so I cannot let you see, too close. But this is the book, and basically this book contains all the information that was leaked on the website, and. The information contains like the personal information, like obviously names, pictures, birthdays, passport numbers, addresses, their children's names and children's birthdays and everything. Like, they have everything in this book, or I should say in the information. And also they have a lot of data that they gathered. And so, what we can tell from the information that was leaked is that police has been surveilled all the Muslims in Japan. And I'm saying this because actually the documents on this book actually states that, like, you know, they are targeting Muslims. They clearly states that. And it's not only, like, you know, some Muslims who might be suspicious, but all of them. And they are very proud to accomplish in making a database on everyone. And they are telling, I mean, like, I'm talking about the documents that police department made to inform other police officers, like, you know, in all over Japan. Basically, like, you know, the police department in Tokyo is telling all the police in you know, in other prefectures to do the same, right? And what we have here is the surveillance cameras in front of the mosques, obviously, and there are people, like, there are police officers watching the mosques the whole time and counting the numbers of the people coming in and coming out. And also they're following those people who are coming to the mosques, and they're making sure, like, where they live, where they work at. And also they are, sometimes they go inside of the mosques and see what kind of activities they're doing. And obviously they have informants, and you know, making, they have a lot of informants, and they are making people to talk about each other. And the sad thing is, like, you know, the informants are not telling the truth all the time. So, like, a lot of information that we have here are clearly not true. And also, there, it's the information tells you that they are getting bank information, or, you know, bank, like, activity histories. With a warrant, they have information about, like, you know, what kind of bank, you know, money transfer you have and stuff. And also they're trying to get information from rental car companies and also hotels. So they are gathering those kind of information without warrant. That's the point of without warrant. And also they are saying they are watching the kids, the young children in elementary school, middle school, high school, and they're worried about homegrown terrorists, and they're trying to spot kids who make prayers, who eat halal food only, you know, like, they bring lunch boxes instead of eating the food that was provided by school. And also, like, you know, sometimes, like, they fast, they skip class, you know, gym classes because of the close regulations and stuff. So, like, they're trying to spot out those kids who are actually practicing. And obviously, they're making a database out of this kind of information. And the database is really, like, you know, database, like, you know, you can put your name and then they have all of your information. The thing is, like, usually, like, in Japan, like, you have, like, kind of like a separated, like, a government, like, you know, police keeps their own information, and the immigration has their own information. They don't really share the information usually. But in this book, like, they share all the information together. And that is scary too. And the thing is, like, they're clearly trying to figure out, like, trying to see how deep your faith is. Like, you know, they have this idea that the more devoted you become, the more dangerous you are. That's the clear message that they have. And I mean, that's the theory they're based on. And I have to say that this is wrong. I mean, I don't know if you have heard of a Brennan Center in New York University. That's a think tank, and they came up with these studies that they seriously did, and they shows that the kind of theory is wrong. Like, I have to ask you to, like, you know, Google it, but like, you can read it. And also, like, you know, there is a book that I would like to explain, introduce. This is, like, you know, a book, Who Speaks for Islam? And this is written by, I don't know, like, you know, this is based on the Gallup Center's studies. And this explains basically, like, you know, the more religious you are, more against you become against terrorism. Basically, like, you know, those Muslims who say yes to the 9/11, September 11th, they have the reasons with, political reasons. But most of them say no to the terrorism attack, and they have the religious reasons. And that shows, like, you know, it's the radicalization theory is wrong that they are based on. And okay, is my time up? Okay, it seems like time is fine. I didn't even say a word about the lawsuit. I'm sorry.
So you can maybe say a few words about the lawsuit.
Okay. Okay, so the lawsuit. So we tried to stop this this book first, and then we did. But we realized that it's not the reason, like, that's not the only thing that we should focus on. So we decided to file the lawsuit against the nation and Tokyo Prefecture, which are basically the police, or they are responsible for the police. And we filed the lawsuit in 2011, and the district court ruling came out in 2014, basically says that the blanket surveillance against Muslims is an activity that is necessary in order to prevent the occurrence of international terrorism. And to distinguish radicalized terrorists from peaceful Muslims, it is necessary to keep all the Muslims under surveillance. And that's the reasoning that they gave us. And unfortunately, the High Court and also the Supreme Court upheld it. So that's the thing that we have now. And we went to the UN, the United Nations committees. Where did it go? I'm sorry. The Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination and Human Rights Committee, and we got recommendations from them. And now, like, the Japanese government have to create a governmental report. But like last year, I went to the hearing for that governmental report, and they clearly told me that they are not doing any surveillance on Muslims. And that's the attitude that they have been having just complete denial, and it's completely against the information that was leaked said, and I think that's really a big problem, and I'm so sorry for talking so long.
No problem. Thank you very much. I think you can elaborate on this during Q&A. Okay. So now we have Professor Repeta.
Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm very happy to be here with my colleagues on the panel, and I think, in particular, Sebastian, I think you did a very good job of providing the big picture of what we've seen transpiring around the world for the past more than a decade, and the shift in the balance. And we think of this as a constitutional issue. We think of this as a balance between protecting individual rights on one hand and protecting the security of the country on the other. And so I think Sebastian described a very big change in the way that balance exists today. And also Ms. Hayashi, of course, giving us an insight in what it's like to be here in Japan and to be subject to police surveillance. And to attempt to use the legal system to seek some kind of a redress. Anyway, I hope everyone shares my shock and fear that's generated when I hear these stories of police surveillance. And we are in Japan, and I'll talk a little bit about the Japanese courts. But one thing that I found very startling about this story is that essentially the very same program was being employed in New York by the New York police at the same time that the Tokyo police were conducting a surveillance of Muslims. It was 2000, and I think as someone mentioned, the leak of the documents in Tokyo was in 2010, I think October of 2010. In 2012, in the United States, the Associated Press won a Pulitzer Prize for a series of investigative articles that disclosed that the New York police had been engaging in exactly the same kind of surveillance program in New York City and in the surrounding states. And so after the Associated Press stories appeared, a lawsuit was filed in federal district court in New Jersey in June of 2012. The AP reported that the New York Police Department, the New Jersey program, and of course, New York is in New York State. The New York police ordinarily do not have authority to conduct operations in New Jersey, but they did it anyway. The AP reported that in New Jersey, the New York police employed surveillance of at least 20 mosques, 14 restaurants, 11 retail stores, 2 grade schools, and university-affiliated Muslim student associations. The NYPD later admitted that its program did not produce a single lead to terrorist activity. So what we see, I believe, is both in Japan and in the United States an almost hysterical overreaction by the police. And when this happens, we ask, well, what protection do we have? What kind of protection exists in the law against this kind of police abuse of power? And of course, well, we think, well, first thing is, we can file a lawsuit and we can go to court and we can raise constitutional issues. And that's exactly what was done in Japan and in the United States. And then what we found is that the courts reacted in almost opposite fashion. The Japanese court said the police action was justified, there's no violation of constitutional rights. In the United States, we got a decision from a federal appellate court that said that if the allegations are true, this is clearly a violation of fundamental rights protected by the U.S. Constitution. And so we think, well, what protection do we have? And of course, the Americans among us think, there's this man named Trump who's the president, and what protections do we have against action by him? And we saw very recently Mr. Trump quickly issued a very broad immigration order which barred people from, was it 8 countries? 1 week later, I think that was January 27th, the following, Friday in February 3rd, a district court judge in Seattle named James Robart issued an order blocking the President of the United States, what we call a TRO, a temporary restraining order. And one interesting aspect of that action was this judge in Seattle, all American federal judges are appointed by the president. He was appointed by Republican President George W. Bush, and he was the judge who issued an order blocking Republican President Donald Trump. So it's one illustration. Another illustration is the Muslim surveillance case. We get a decision by a federal appellate court which clearly states that this type of police action is a violation of constitutional rights. So that in the United States, courts are often willing to they're willing to issue decisions which hold the executive accountable and may directly state that the executive is violating constitutional rights. In Japan, that is almost non-existent. In this particular case, it was especially shocking because the analysis of the courts is so poor. And in fact, and so we think, of course, we need police and we need security and we need police to conduct investigations. But ordinarily, they conduct investigations when they have some evidence, some significant evidence that a crime is taking place or about to take place. In the case of the Muslim surveillance, there was no such evidence in the United States. There was no such evidence in Japan. A decision was simply made to conduct surveillance of the entire Muslim population. The federal appellate court in the United States, well, this is clearly a violation of the non-discrimination principle. In the United States, it's called equal protection. Because the police action, the government action, was based on religious affiliation. And the government is prohibited from taking action based on, the government is prohibited from discriminating on the basis of religion. In the Japan litigation, the attorneys, Ms. Hayashi and her colleagues, claimed that this action violated freedom of religion, it violated the non-discrimination principle, which is in the Japanese Constitution, Article 14, and also violated the right to privacy. We have a long decision by the Tokyo District Court, and Ms. Hayashi and her colleagues translated this entire decision into English. It's an excellent translation, which is, you know, for those of us who study Japanese law, this is really valuable to find a good translation of a court decision. It's very, very hard to do. And as she mentioned, they also filed litigation in Japan. At the same time, they filed statements with two United Nations-related committees. Japan is a member of several international human rights treaties, and those major treaties establish committees to review issues. Every member of the treaty, every country is required to submit periodic reports, and then others, whether it's NGOs or bar associations or Ms. Hayashi's team, are able to file counter reports. And they filed a very detailed counter report with both the United Nations Committee on Human Rights and the United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. Both of those committees in 2014 issued what are called conclusions and observations. So the committees do not have power to issue orders. They can only make recommendations. In any case, both of those committees criticized the Japanese police and called upon them to stop any sort of religious profiling. Those recommendations by the United Nations have been ignored. So where are we? Again, we step back and we think about this balance. And if you study American law, you think, my gosh, the President of the United States a couple of weeks ago said, the news media is the enemy of the American people. Now, you know, what can you say about that? Well, you can say, you know, if Thomas Jefferson were alive today, he said, newspapers are more important than the government. If James Madison were alive today, he's the primary author of the United States Constitution, which prohibits the government from restricting the freedom of the press. Freedom of the press has been, you know, a bedrock principle of American law from the very beginning for 230 years. We now have a president who says the press is the enemy of the American people. We don't have time this evening to discuss the implications of that, but I guess my point is just, in the United States, we have a very, very well-established set of legal principles based on countless court decisions and history over the past 230 years, which has entrenched the news media, the press, and its role in protecting free speech, our free speech, in allowing us, the people, to get access to information. I mean, how do we get information about what's going on? Traditionally, we read the newspaper. Now we look online. We need news reporters, truth tellers, right, who gather information. If a government official is lying, the only way we can find out is if someone investigates and tells the truth. So our system deeply relies on an independent news media. In this case, the Muslim surveillance case, in the United States, how did we find out about it? The Associated Press, right? This is our greatest news wire service, as they call it, one of our institutional news companies. The AP investigated, it released these stories, it deeply investigated lots of detail about this surveillance. They won the Pulitzer Prize. In Japan's case, there was no such news investigation. Instead, we know about this because someone, we don't know who, a whistleblower, leaked these documents on the internet. And so, therefore, we know about the case. We know what the police were doing. This is one example. We know of other examples where the police, Japanese police, public security police, have conducted intensive surveillance on targets. So the two cases provide very important information for us to consider. In Professor Cleveland's email, if that was distributed, he provided a link to an article which is on the Asia Pacific Journal, called Spying on Muslims in Tokyo and New York. And then the subtitle is, question, necessary and unavoidable? That's because that was the language used by the Tokyo District Court. The Tokyo District Court said, in this environment that Professor Maslow described, it's necessary and unavoidable that the police have essentially unlimited power to investigate us without our knowledge, even though they don't have any evidence of possible wrongdoing or crime. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This is just coincidence, but all of us on this panel have this book in Japanese, but this is a book about this Muslim surveillance program and the leaked documents from police onto the internet in 2010. And this is edited by investigative journalists and lawyers who support the Muslim community in Tokyo, in Japan. And if you read this volume, you're gonna be very familiar with what is going on between police and the Muslim community and what kind of informations were gathered by the police department in Tokyo. Okay, so we can recommend this book for all of you if you are interested in this book.
Masaki,
Do you mind if I just, we can just pass it around? Don't keep it.
Yeah, actually, this book, the legal team of the lawsuit, we actually made this book. We had a symposium, and we made the book out of it.
And just let me give you some additional background about this surveillance program in Tokyo or in Japan. So in Japan, we have about 100,000 Muslim residents. 90% of this population are foreign nationals, and then 10% are Japanese Muslims, Japanese converts. And according to this book, more than 70,000 Muslims were spied on out of 100,000 Muslims. It means this was a kind of mass survey or a census about this particular community. Okay, so there is no discrimination or distinction between law-abiding citizens and potential or possible terrorists. Okay, so if you belong to this community, you're most likely to be spied on, and the police may have your very sensitive private information ranging from your family, bank account, job, and any kind of locations where you stop by, where you eat, where you drink, and so on. Okay, so this is a very wide range survey. Okay, Professor Maslow mentioned that there is a unit in Tokyo Police which is in charge of counter-terrorism measures, okay, and this unit is called the Third Division of Foreign Affairs, which is in charge of global terrorism. The Third Division, it means we have the first and the second divisions of foreign affairs. The first one was in charge of communist threat established during the Cold War period. So they are looking at the Soviet Union and some other communist countries in Eastern Europe and their spies in Japan. The second division is in charge of North Korea and communist China. Okay. And according to this book, in the book there is a chapter written by a journalist, and he suggested that this Muslim surveillance program was a new task for Tokyo Police, which had lost its agenda when the Soviet Union collapsed. Communist threat disappeared. But police is a bureaucratic organization, and any kinds of organization has to have its reason to exist. It means you have to have agenda and task so that you can keep your organization running, and also you can ask for a budget. Police lost the old agenda, communism, and its threat. And what happened is the September 11th in 2001 and the diffusion of new global terrorism. And it seems that the police found this as an opportunity to survive and to keep their organization running. Okay, so we are talking about this third division of foreign affairs, which is conducting this surveillance program on the Muslim community. And personally, I think this topic is very important and timely because I am a university teacher here, teaching the politics of the Middle East and political science in general. And I do have students from the Middle East, okay? And I talk to some of them, and they know that they are being spied. Whenever they go to mosques for praying, they told me that they saw someone spying on the mosque, right? So that they are well aware of this program. And it is possible that police may contact us to ask to share the information about those students with police. And we know that Japanese universities are being contacted by police and being asked to share the information about Muslim students. As universities, as a teacher, we have to think about how to deal with this request, okay? And this is a problem because the Japan Supreme Court concluded that this surveillance program is not unconstitutional. It decided that this is necessary and unavoidable. Okay, so the question is, you know, as higher education administrators, you know, can we reject police request to share the information about those Muslims? Okay, and this is my kind of private concern. Okay, let me put some questions for our panelists. Okay, so. It seems that we do conclude that this program is violating our human rights and unconstitutional, and maybe this program doesn't really work well. It is not really the best way of preventing a possible terrorism from happening. Many experts argue that this program is wasting a huge amount of resources, including the money and officers, right? So then what could be a better alternative to prevent global terrorism from happening inside this country, right? If we remove this surveillance program, what could be an option, alternative for national security? We have to find a good balance between human rights and national security. Right, so maybe this is a question for Professor Maslow, if you can talk about this from the viewpoint of international relations and political science, I will be appreciative. And then for Ms. Hayashi, I would like you to elaborate on what exactly happened to Muslims in Tokyo, how negatively were they affected because of this program. Could you share some stories about what really happened to them? Okay, and also, when this program was leaked onto the internet, how did the public in Japan react? Right, because I think this is not a problem only for the Muslim community, because it may happen to all of us. Right, if you are not, I mean, if you have any kind of religion, or if you're a minority in Japan, you could be spied on. So it is a problem for all of us. And particularly, we could reasonably expect that other religious organizations, non-Muslim organizations, would protest or would work with the Muslim community to defend their rights of freedom. But in 2010, I was not in Japan. I was studying in the US. So personally, I was not really aware of this leak. So I was curious, how did the general public respond or react when this document was leaked? Okay. And my final question for Professor Repeta was, what was the logic behind the Supreme Court's decision that this program was necessary? What kind of, you know, reasoning did the judges provide?
I'll try to give a very brief answer to your difficult question, I have to say, to open the floor for further questions. I think when we talk about terrorism and the threat of global terrorism, I think the first what we have to do is to give up the idea that there's 100% security. The terrorist threat is something that advanced societies, particularly Germany, the UK, even Japan, it's a threat that they have faced in the 60s and 70s, and they have coped with it rather successfully. I think the best answer to the terrorist threat is an open society itself. That means the integration of minorities, and through integration, the building of trust and a tolerant multicultural society. As I'm German, the talk about multiculturalism has been an ongoing project since the early 90s, particularly with the Green Party coming into government in 1998. I'm an advocate and a supporter of this particular concept. The concept of an open society in general, I think, is the best prevention of terrorism, and I think there's no other way of dealing with this issue.
So I'll talk about the effects that was the effects on the Muslims here. I'm glad that he asked because I wanted to talk about it and I didn't have time. So here is what I heard. Some people who got fired because of the information that was leaked, and also I'm talking about the people who are actually on this list. The names are on this list, and some people have had restaurants, and their business went really, really bad because of this book. And people stopped coming because they stated as if this is where the terrorists are meeting, and to discuss what to do. So that happened, and also because this information was given to foreign governments, some people from, let's say, Middle East couldn't go back to their country because they're acting as if they were terrorists. I mean, they were described as terrorists, so they couldn't go back to their country anymore, so they had to naturalize themselves to Japan, to this country that they that made them a terrorist, right? And a lot of people who are on this list, or maybe not on the list, but who are Muslims, are married to Japanese converts. And when I say the converts, some of them are converts like myself. I converted to Islam before I got married. But there are a lot of people, a lot of Japanese men and women who got married and who converted Islam at basically at the same time. And those people sometimes are not really strong in faith. And they get scared. They got really scared of the information that was leaked. And also by the fact that police is surveilling us. And a lot of people had argument between the husbands and wife. And some of them got divorced. Some of them got nearly divorced. And they have Japanese families who are not Muslims, and their families got really scared, really upset, and they tried to spread them out again. And even if those things didn't happen, a lot of people, with the cases that didn't happen, a lot of people stopped going to the mosques because they don't like being surveilled. And especially for the kids, the little kids, they are deprived of the opportunities to go to the mosques and actually learn what to be a Muslim, or about their own lineage or history or something like that. And that was really really shocking to our community in large. And also the public reaction about the leak, I don't really remember it became the huge impact on the way that he described, as if this could be us next target could be us. I don't think people actually had that kind of perspective, and that's one of the things that I kept telling people, that this is not a Muslim thing, this is not a Muslim, especially Muslim thing, it's just happening to us because we are the minorities. We are, most of us are foreigners, and we are really weak in the sense, legally protected. But it could be happening to any of you guys anytime, and that's why I really think it's important for old. I know you. Most of you are not Japanese, right? Even Japanese people.
Briefly add to this point with regard to the public reaction to the leak. If you do a Japanese source on the internet about media articles covering this, you won't find many, as a matter of fact. And if you do, again, as I've tried to explain in my comments, the media has described the leak as a counter-terrorism failure, more or less, as a failure of the police authorities to control the data, to circumvent the leak as such. But as far as I know, even the liberal media, for instance, Tokyo newspaper, the Asahi newspaper, they have failed to frame this as a human rights issue. And this is crucial, and this reflects on how the general public perceives this. It's not about minority rights in Japan. It's an issue of how state authorities control data, public data. And so this is the way it has been perceived. And so there's very few coverage in the media that frames this as a human rights issue per se. And I think this is worth to notice here.
So. To follow up what he said. So when this document was leaked on the internet, it was in September 2010. We were in Japan just talking about the territorial dispute over Senkaku because in September, a Chinese fishing boat collided with Japan's Coast Guard ship. So we just paid attention to this incident by ignoring this surveillance program and its disclosure, okay? And also, Professor Maslow was talking about this problem of securitization. This is a kind of a technical term in the study of world politics. Securitization means we change how we see issues. We change how we talk about issues and subjects. So, in principle, this surveillance program should be talked on the basis of human rights and civil liberties. But now this issue is defined and framed as an issue of national security. Okay? And when we see it as an issue of security, then we just exclude human rights dimensions in this discussion. So, this discourse is obviously produced and constructed by political authorities, but also we have to have the audience who accepts, buys, and embraces this discourse. And this audience is the public in general. So we have a resonance between the authority which produces this discourse and who accept this discourse. So that this process of securitization is now completed, right? So this is not an issue of human rights in Japan. This is how the media covered back in 2010.
So I focused mainly on, you know, what the courts have done. And of course, judges reflect the societies that they're part of. This case, you know, shows really a completely opposite reaction. When you look at the American judges, and you know, we're looking at 230 years of history of the U.S. Constitution and the evolution of the notion of equal protection, which came out after the Civil War initially, and then in the 1930s. While in Germany, the Nazis were murdering Jews, and in the American South, black men were being lynched. The justices in the Supreme Court in Washington knew about this, and they had a case, very famous case, where they said, well, when we look at constitutional rights, there are some that are more important than others. And the most important ones are the fundamental rights that are listed in the what we call the Bill of Rights, including freedom of speech and freedom of religion, and also the freedom from discrimination. So we got that decision by the U.S. Supreme Court in the 1930s, and then we've had countless decisions since. So American judges are very sensitized, and American society is very sensitized to the issue of of attempting to treat minorities fairly and attempting to apply the law in a fair way. And if you read the decision by the Third Circuit Court of Appeals in Philadelphia in this case, at the very end, the judges actually wrote this. They wrote, "We have," and they're talking about the surveillance, Muslim surveillance case, and they write, "We have been down similar roads before. Jewish Americans during the Red Scare, African Americans during the Civil Rights Movement, Japanese Americans during World War II are examples that readily spring to mind. We are left to wonder why we cannot see with foresight what we see so clearly with hindsight, that loyalty is a matter of the heart and the mind, not race, creed, or color." So these are sentences written by US federal judges. And we clearly have these ideals, and we spend a great deal of time trying to understand and apply these ideals. In Japan, there's no such history. In this case, the Muslim surveillance case in Japan, the response of the courts is just very, very disappointing. The Supreme Court of Japan did not address the issues at all. It simply rubber-stamped the decisions below. It was only the Tokyo District Court, the lowest level, that actually issued a lengthy opinion, as I mentioned earlier, which has been translated to English. And so you ask, what was the logic? Well, in the United States, the logic is applying the constitutional principle. And as I mentioned, in the 1930s, we got this idea that certain types of rights are more important and deserve greater protection. And so if a government action, like surveillance by the police, may violate one of those rights, the government has a very heavy burden to show that this is fair and just. In Japan, the Japanese courts have not adopted such a rule. There is no, what we call in the United States, the strict scrutiny test. Japanese courts do not use it. In the district court decision in Tokyo in the surveillance case, the judges actually wrote, "The early detection for the prevention of international terrorism of terrorists under the guise of ordinary citizens necessitates an assessment of how Muslims constitute and run their communities. We Japanese police must understand how the Muslims constitute and run their communities. And it follows that there is no other way to discern whether one is a peaceful Muslim or a terrorist belonging to a radical Islamic group, etc., other than to make presumptions from various circumstances observable from external manifestations, such as their participation in religious activities and so forth." So the Tokyo District Court completely justifies surveillance cameras outside mosques, the use of informants, and so on, because there is some, they think, some threat of international terrorism, even though no such incident has ever occurred in Japan.
Thank you very much. Now I think we should move on to Q&A and discussion between the panelists and the audience.
Everyone, we'd like to welcome you to come up here and ask questions. Please note that we are video recording this and we have a YouTube channel that this will be published on. So you're essentially giving implicit consent by coming up to this mic. We ask that you just ask a focused question and not necessarily make statements. You don't need to wait to be called on. You can just come up and even line up if you wish. Okay, so don't be shy. We'd like to hear your questions.
Hi. You mentioned that out of the Muslim community in Japan, roughly 90% are foreigners and 10% are Japanese nationals. And you also mentioned that roughly 90% of Muslim like 90% of the Muslim community was had surveillance. So I was wondering if the 10% of Japanese nationals among that community had less surveillance.
That's actually not what happens. Because like one of the people that I have here, or a few people actually, are Muslim and Japanese, and 90%, this just means like they just reached 90% by that time. Mm-hmm. Like I'm sure they have a lot more by now. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, goal is definitely 100%.
Hi, so I've noticed a strong championship by the panel of individual rights, but looking from a security perspective, let's raise, for example, a tool used by some security services called profiling. What would be your opinion on that? So for example, a 90-year-old grandmother, should she receive the same amount of attention from the police as someone else? Where would you draw the line? So would you say, well, it's okay by age, you know, okay to profile by age, but not by religion? What about physical condition? I think it raises a lot of questions, and I'd be interested to hear your response.
Thank you. I think as Professor Repeta has made the case, I think you need, the government needs to have a very strong explanation for why it has those measures in place to start with. Based on whatever criteria they apply, be it religion, physical conditions, or whatever, you need to have a very strong explanation for why you apply these measures.
Yeah, Sebastian's exactly right. So, of course, the police are the experts in crime detection, crime solving, and apprehending criminals and so forth. And so it's up to the government, the police, to develop a program which is based on some rational approach to whether it's limiting crime, preventing crime, but it cannot be simply targeting an entire segment of the society based on their religious affiliation. I mean, the law is very clear in that regard.
Thank you for the speech. My question is relating to recent incident of Japanese citizen execution in the ISIS area. My question is, how did the investigation or surveillance program, did it get worse, or did the investigation get worse after that incident? How did the public react? Is there anything, like, were there protests against embassies of these countries or in Japan, in Tokyo?
I have to say that I cannot really tell, like, if it got, the surveillance got worse or better, because, like, surveillance is usually done the way that we cannot tell. Mm-hmm. And having said that, I have to say that, like, actually, like, you know, how we personally feel got worse because of the incident. Like, you know, the a lot of coverage from the media and these things kind of hardened people's feelings towards Muslims in Japan, and that made it a little bit, like, you know, hard on us, especially with the name. Like, you know, it's actually not only about the incident, but also the name Islamic State has been really, really affecting us a lot. Like, you know, Islamic State as if, like, and they are the representative of Islam, right? But, like, you know, what we see as, like, so un-Islamic from them. And just because of the name, that, you know, people assume that we support them, and that's so not true. And because of that names, like, you know, we have a lot more, like, harsh reactions, and also, like, you know, I heard that kids are being bullied by that, and I think it's very sad, and, like, you really want them to change their names.
May I ask for a follow-up question? Okay.
Maybe I'll get your follow-up question. Beside the surveillance program, though, you asked about the impact of ISIS in general on Japan's counterterrorism. It's very clear that this incident had a huge impact on Japan's public because it was a major trigger for the Abe government to beef up its counterterrorist measures. For instance, in 2015, just after the ISIS killing of Goto Kenji and what was the other name? I forgot. Yeah, exactly. The Abe government introduced pledged to the International Terrorism Intelligence Gathering Unit that I've outlined in my comments. It also increased the budget for counterterrorism in general with the Public Security Intelligence Agency, with the Ministry of Justice. It also increased the staff which is allocated to these units. It's not very spectacular. We talk about 20 people who are within this unit in charge of counterterrorism in general, in comparison to, let's say, weapons exports and dealing with those issues. Mm-hmm. It doesn't really add up, but the Abe government has been very active on this, and the major cause for this was obviously ISIS in 2015.
Thank you. Question has been answered.
First of all, I'd like to thank everyone for a very informative and important presentation. I've learned a lot today. My question regards what happens after the surveillance, and I base this question upon a recent case in Canada. There were two couples that were basically drug addicts, recovering drug addicts, Canadian citizens, who became or self-radicalized, but they didn't have any means to carry out any terrorist activity whatsoever. If you want to Google the case, it's John Nuttall and Amanda Cody. They went through a trial, and what happened is the Royal Canadian Mounted Police started a sting operation on them and became friends with them. They had people that looked like Muslims from Middle Eastern countries portraying to be terrorists, and they pushed them into a plan to put these pressure cooker bombs in Victoria at the legislative building. And in the wisdom of the judge that heard the case, they were found guilty. And after the guilty phase of the trial comes entrapment. And entrapment is very, very hard to prove in Canada. But this judge found that the couple had been entrapped, that basically the police had created these terrorists. And it's a fantastic information on the internet. It shows the surveillance cameras in the car when this couple is kind of at a loss, and they get to the pressure because they think they're dealing with national terrorists, and they think they have to carry this out or they're going to be killed. And so I'm wondering, in Japan, with the information, the surveillance information, is there a possibility that they are now using some of that information and trying to entrap people, going in and acting as if they were terrorists themselves, trying to entrap people? So if anybody has any information on that, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
I've never heard of any such case in Japan. But, you know, this kind of follows up with the earlier question the gentleman mentioned about, you know, what would be allowable activity by the police? And obviously, this type of case where the police have targeted someone and then entrapped them, otherwise these people would not have been involved in a crime but for the police participation. And it just raises this issue again of how do you manage the police? You know, and it's a very, very difficult problem. And the article I mentioned, I think the first page is passing around. You know, we have litigation in Japan. In the New York case, we actually had two separate lawsuits. One was filed in New Jersey. The other one was filed in New York about Muslim surveillance. And the New Jersey case, as I mentioned, went to the Third Circuit Court of Appeals. The New York case, on the other hand, was settled between the City of New York government and lawyers for the ACLU and other lawyers representing the Muslim community. And the terms of that settlement is available on the internet. One of the aspects of it is that within the police, there's some kind of committee that oversees investigations. And as part of the settlement, the city of New York agreed that a citizen representative could participate on that committee. And that citizen representative would be a lawyer who's never worked for the city, the police, or the city government, and would be appointed for 5 years, and would be in a position to review cases of investigation. And a part of the settlement said that, you know, investigations could not be based solely on religious affiliation. I mean, there has to be some other grounds for suspicion. The police have to have some evidence that there is a threat or a risk of some criminal behavior.
Okay. I come from the business community, not the law community, so I apologize for that in advance. But I'm always thinking in terms of what is the benefit and what is the liability? What is the advantage we have here? What are we going to achieve here? And what are the problems that are going to be caused? And I can't see the benefit of this kind of surveillance, except for the one issue of bureaucracy. Got to do something with these people, so have them do this. Can't find another activity, have it do this. So I'm thinking in those terms, is the surveillance community expertise, I don't know if we have any experts here, so crude that they have to go to these kinds of methods to find our terrorists out there, of which we all want to find? That's my main issue. We're looking at a terrorist problem, but we're addressing something else. And do you have any comments on the expertise or possibly the police want to do a good job. They don't want to be, you know, delinquent in their duty. They want to do their job. Is the expertise moving forward, or are we just moving in different directions on this? Do you have any feelings on that point?
What are the benefits of the surveillance program? That's also a very difficult question to answer. Let me indirectly answer your question in terms of how efficient was the program to start with. You know, there's a case of Lionel Dumont, who was actually a known Al-Qaeda affiliate who was frequently traveling in and out of Japan in 2002, was it? 2001? And the Japanese authorities did not catch him. So you've got to answer yourself. You have an entire apparatus focusing on the Muslim community, and then there was no one that they could actually, there was no evidence that they could find from within the community in Japan that had links to Al-Qaeda or other terrorist organizations. And then you have a known Al-Qaeda-affiliated terrorist who's flying in and out of Japan who didn't get recognized by the authorities. Then that answers a lot about the efficiency of these programs to start with. Secondly, and also what happens, to go back to the other question that's been raised, what happens after surveillance? Again, what we don't know yet, for instance, is does this surveillance program still go on, or has it been shut down? The police authorities have not provided any information about this. Second aspect is, why did this program actually come to life? The third division, as it has been established in 2002 by the Koizumi government, Professor Kakizaki has outlined, then there's the first division and the third division that has been in place for many, many years and that had expertise in countering left-wing terrorism, foreign infiltrations by North Korean agents in Japan. So these divisions had actually a record of successful counter-espionage, to some degree at least. So the third division was under tremendous pressure to come up with a certain result, which explains why it has so expensively spied on its Muslim community to start with, at the timing that it did in 2002. So the pressure within the police department was enormous on this particular division, and so hence the massive scope of the program. But in terms of its efficiency, I think I've answered this with reference to actual terrorists flying out of Japan who did not get recognized, which I think accounts for a lot of these programs and its efficiency.
And I think there was also political pressure on the side of the Japanese government to demonstrate that they are doing something to deal with counterterrorism, particularly prior to the G7 summit in Japan. So president and prime ministers from other countries are coming to Japan. And, you know, the government believed that even if there was no imminent threat in society, but they have to do something about it. And they were using this surveillance program against communist organizations and radical left-wing organizations during the Cold War period, and they simply applied this method to the Muslim community, right? But communist organizations are really different from Muslim organizations or networks in terms of the structure of the organization. Communist organizations are quite rigid and hierarchically organized. In the Muslim community, we don't have this organization. It's just the group of people who believe in the same religion, and they are not organized based upon a mosque. So I doubt that this method is really effective or efficient in preventing possible terrorism. That's my impression.
Thank you very much, everyone, for your presentations tonight. I'm not a lawyer either, but I won't apologize for that. I would like to ask a question maybe from a little bit of a different perspective. I understand what Professor Kakizaki said about the media did not really cover this, and the way it was covered, as Professor Maslow said, was not in a really positive way. I would like to ask a two-part question that's a little bit about what's happened in the past and a little bit looking towards the future, because I believe, as somebody who works in civil society, every crisis proposes opportunities for the future, for something better. Where were civil society actors in this? I don't believe, I'm sorry if I don't have such great trust in the Japanese media. I kind of feel that it's the place of civil society actors and civic organizations to actually educate the public, not the media. The media is just a tool. So what was done, say, with civil society actors after this in 2010? For example, Amnesty, Human Rights Watch, Human Rights Now, Hansabits Kuksayundo, all these JCLU. What was actually done to influence the public to not make, or the government, to actually not go in this direction, one, and interfaith organizations? Two, where can we go for the future? Because I think I just personally see so much potential to actually bring this in a positive light, because this can happen to anyone in the future. This can happen to other communities. We don't know what's around the corner. But if there's a lot of opportunity for collaboration. So I'd just like to ask, what happened thus far? And where do you see we can go in the future? Thanks.
I have to say that I'm not really following what those organizations really, but as far as I have in touch with those people personally, honestly, I have to say that they didn't know about this issue. I mean, by the time that I actually speak to them, and those, for example, we just had a mosque tour, a small mosque tour, with the Imadar people, we wrote some articles about this issue on their magazines, and I think I have to say that it's actually starting now that they are realizing that we have these issues in the society too. I mean, traditionally, they have been focusing on other type of discriminations, and now they are acknowledging the fact that we have this issue too. So hopefully, we are gonna do something together. And actually, we started talking to each other more often these days, and I think we can do something about it in the future too. I mean, we definitely need to come close. I mean, come together to battle this issue. I mean, obviously, Muslims are not, I mean, good enough or whatever for it to challenge this by ourselves. And we definitely need to come together. Yeah, thank you.
One more thing to add here. Of course, there was in 2011 and last year as well, there were a series of symposia who were actually addressing these issues, rather popular symposia. But again, those were not picked up by the media. And so you've got those events that actually take place, but you need to have a platform that takes it out. The second thing is, if you go through the book, the Japanese book that we have circulated, one of the few things I was personally shocked by was reading the accounts of the victims and the journalists who were covering it, was the willingness by which society in Japan actually cooperated with these surveillance programs. Banks who were under very vague legal ground providing bank information of those surveilled, for instance. Universities who were providing records of their overseas students. Landlords who were providing information on their customers. And so on and so on. So what is more shocking here is not civil society who is opposing these things, but society in general who is supporting this. And so the question should be, why is that? Why is Japanese society in general so willing to not ask second questions with regard to these programs?
So one of the answers to Sebastian's question is concerns the news media itself and concerns this particular case. And of course, as you know, Sarah Jean, in Japan, NGOs in general are very weak. They have very, very limited budgets. They tend not to have a professional staff and so on. So they generally have little power. But the news media, of course, does. And Japan's news media essentially does not criticize the police. The news media, it has the opportunity. If a court will rule against the police, then the news reports can report the court decision. But large Japanese news organizations in general will not criticize the police. And I believe this is part of a transaction, right? You read your newspaper, you turn on the television, and we get all these reports on the latest murder that happened someplace. And in each of those cases, of course, the news reporter received information from police sources. Often when, for example, by the way, there's an event this very evening, a demonstration in front of the Prime Minister's residence about an Okinawan protester who has now been held in detention for more than 4 months without a trial for very trivial charges. But anyway, I think the news media essentially refused to criticize the police. And that has a big effect throughout society.
So I don't think I can beat that last question because it's a pretty good question. And a lot of what I wanted to ask kind of already touched upon, so I just want to go along with that. I guess I should start by saying greetings to whoever's here from the intelligence apparatus counting us. Also, hello on YouTube to whoever has to tally and write up these questions and who asked them, along with facial details. So my feeling is that I don't feel very positive about this issue. We don't have a political atmosphere locally and or globally now, thanks to my president. And we're kind of in a place where people don't have much power to make the change. And so I think we've just touched upon this, and I'd just like to ask you to kind of expound or talk about how do you feel that the public awareness, an aversion to violating the Constitution of Japan, violating human rights, how do you feel that this this public awareness exists or doesn't exist? And is there a positive possible change that might happen? Or is it a positive change that needs to be led? I'd like to hear. Thank you.
about? That's, again, it's an open question. I share your pessimism with regard to the current situation. No question about that. As I've outlined, at least with regard to Japan, I only comment on Japan as this is the only country that I'll probably be capable of making any knowledgeable comment. I think the direction that we go towards is a more one of a security state in that sense, more surveillance, more public willingness of accepting those new norms. As that you see or you sense, and I'll share your sense again in Japan, a sense of a grown intensified insecurity. North Korea, China, the global terrorist threat, all this plays into it. And I don't see a positive sign towards or against that, to say. And again, the Abe government is playing those threats up, as did their predecessor governments, in a very skillful way. The media doesn't question those new narratives. In fact, it uses those new narratives, and a trait of that that Larry has outlined. I don't have any comments on what will happen. Beside that, I share your skepticism in general. I'm rather pessimistic. I think we'll see a growth of the surveillance apparatus rather than a limitation of those measures. In fact, the current government is building on the surveillance program and is expanding it with what they call the conspiracy law that catalogs 670 plus crimes under which people can be detained in Japan, groups, but the definitions of those crimes, of those groups that are targeted, are very vague. The government does not provide very detailed explanations on these new measures and the standards that they apply. So again, I think the signs are towards more surveillance, a stronger security apparatus, and less civil liberties in this regard.
Look, nobody's giving up, right? And I think the older people of us in this room are looking to the younger people to provide energy and enthusiasm and passion to fight to preserve a society where people are treated fairly and the government does not have too much power. You know, the story from history is very clear, right? Humanity has been through situations, dictatorial situations, where governments have had too much power and have abused it, and we know that. And you know, we know that in order to preserve a democratic society, it really requires a tremendous amount of effort by ordinary people.
I think I would like to add to what these two say. Here in Japan, we still have the immigrants. A lot of majority of the Muslim population here are immigrants, and we are about to have a lot of second generations. I think that will be a game changer. Like, you know, we never had this before, and like America or Europe. A lot of second, third generations have been like having a really good power, and I know they are struggling, but still, like, they're a part of the society, and they actually have some power, and I think that's what we can. I don't want to say like, you know, we're gonna expect to the next generation, but like, you know, I mean, like, that can be a good thing that can happen.
Just to add on that, I think it is very sad or ironic that this leaked document on the surveillance program reveals that the Japanese government is seeing Muslims as suspects and possible terrorists, while the government is now reaching out to Muslim societies to attract more and more foreign tourists and guests and workers, right? Now we have foreign nurses and healthcare providers. they study hard to pass the test to work in Japan as a healthcare provider. They are learning Japanese, but they are also, many of them are Muslims. So we have this kind of contradiction. Okay, we are trying to communicate with Muslim societies in a more productive way. And we may want to establish a much better relations. At the same time, this program indicates strongly that still the government is seeing Muslims as suspects. So this is very ironic, I would say.
Thank you for your presentation. For my question, just to add a little point to the question earlier about the efficiency and the effectiveness of the surveillance program, I might also add that despite the massive police investment in surveillance and monitoring of the radical left in Japan, the police were still not able to notice that Shigeru Fusaku, for example, came into the country 17 years ago. It was only because of a tip-off that they actually realized she was already in the country and had snuck in under a false passport. So despite all the money that was invested into looking at the Japanese radical left, actually there were massive holes and gaps in what they were actually able to do as a police force. But onto my question, we've heard so far in questions and comments about the response of the civil society and the response of the media in Japan to the Muslim surveillance program. I would just like to ask a question specifically about street protests and activism. Have there been any street protests by Muslims or Muslim groups in relation to protesting this issue of the surveillance program, either recently or when the leak first emerged? And then just to link on to the final symposium in this series next month, which is about protests in general, what I would be interested to hear your thoughts on the wider impact of the this program or the revelation of this program on street protest culture in Japan in general and activism. Specifically, do you think the knowledge that there is such a program as this, a surveillance program, has an impact on scaring people off being activists on the streets or on taking the streets and protesting, knowing that they will be photographed by the Korwan, by the Security Bureau? Although we are talking about a very specific surveillance program, about one demographic in Japan, the Muslim, as you've made many times the comment tonight, this could be quite easily applied to all kinds of other groups in Japan. Do you think, I'm sure you probably will think this, that do you think that knowing that such a program exists scares particularly young people off, young students off from themselves committing to go to the streets to protest an entirely unrelated issue, but knowing in the back of their mind, this is the kind of thing that could happen to me, they could be surveyed and they could be their career and their academic prospects in the future?
As far as I know, there was no protest, street protest about this issue. And that's actually a good point. I've never thought about it. But probably because, like, you know, people are really shocked about this thing. And, you know, obviously, when you're shocked about surveillance, you don't want to make yourself surveilled more. And also one of the things that happened really interesting here is that, like I said before, the information is quite wrong. And the thing is, like, they made the informants talk about each other, and they basically, you know, told you know, a lot of lies about each other. So they're not happy with, you know, each other at this moment, like, you know, because that person said about this and this about me, and that person said, you know, that and that about me, right? So, like, Muslims here are all victims, but not their, I mean, they cannot come together. It was one of the challenges that we had as a, you know, when we filed the lawsuit, because usually, like, those victims come together and, like, you know, set a plaintiff meeting stuff, but we never had it because we couldn't get them together, and that was one of the things. And I think someone else can ask.
Thank you very much. We have less than 5 minutes to the end, so two more questions. Please be brief and short. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So I think there is this general sense of pessimism in the room right now, and I'd like to ask a question about the concrete things that we can do to confront the situation and to protest against it. So I think Professor Maslow mentioned that one of the most surprising things is how easily banks, universities, and various institutions just sort of complied with the police. And also Professor Kakizaki mentioned how universities are asked information about Muslim students. What happens when people refuse to give this information to the police? You know, what happens if you refuse to do so? Is there any, you know, will anything happen to you? And how can people sort of protest the situation in various ways? Thank you.
That was my own question to, you know, what happens if we refuse to work with police in Japan?
Some similar examples, excuse me, appeared in the United States immediately after the 9/11 incident. You may recall George W. Bush was the president. The attorney general was a man named Ashcroft. And the FBI and American police forces took very aggressive action to apprehend people and obtain information. And the U.S. Congress very rapidly passed a new law called the USA Patriot Act. And in the new regime, there was something called a national security letter, which was used in place of a warrant. It was earlier mentioned that courts issued warrants. The police, if they're going to search your house, for example, they need to go to a judge and get approval from the judge in the form of a warrant. In order to get that approval, the police have to show reasonable cause. There are some, they have good grounds to think that there's criminal activity taking place and so on. Well, under the USA Patriot Act, we had something called the National Security Letters, which are not issued by a court, but were issued by the FBI itself. And under the National Security Letters, the FBI agents could receive lots of information, as we were discussing, from hotels or libraries and so on, about their patrons. And there was some litigation. In the United States, in particular, public libraries put up their backs. In the United States, there's a tradition that public libraries, have a very important role in society, and that they should never be used as tools of police investigations, and that your records, the public library, are personal information, and so on. And so there was litigation related to that. But I guess my point is that in the United States, I think, you know, there's a mentality, there has been a mentality, it may be weakening, that we do not have, the police do not have a carte blanche power to demand information. In Japan, on the other hand, you've got a very, very different history, and I think it's much less likely that you could develop resistance. And how do you go about developing resistance? I think the only tool that we have is education, right?
Hi. So I'm with a lot of my other classmates here. We're students at Temple University. And I know from conversations with them, we have a lot of conversations about how this is, you know, it's really terrible that this is happening. But the question that always comes up is, you know, what can we do about it as students, as, you know, non-credentialed? We're not professionals. We're not lawyers. We're not politicians. We're just kind of kids. So I guess we kind of feel kind of hopeless when we see something like this, and we don't actually know, you know, what can we do? So I guess that's my question. In a situation like this, what is someone like me or someone like my classmates supposed or, you know, encouraged to do when they see something like this?
Again, as Larry said, education, I think, is to so many issues the key. Be aware of those things is, I think, the most important step towards getting rid of these regulations. Again, in the material that we have passed, particularly I have been very pessimistic about these developments in Japan, but it doesn't mean that there are positive signs. I mean, there's investigative journalism. The gentleman who is in charge of editing this, Aoki Osamu, who is a very renowned investigative journalist in Japan, who's vigorously opposing police force in Japan through his journalist activities, who makes those things public, who publishes very regularly on police action in Japan, their surveillance measures, who's been very present on television. So there are those actors as well, and not that many, but some at least. But I'll definitely agree with Larry. Education and awareness of those things is, I think, the most important key to this.
Sure, education is obviously the core, and you know, discussing these issues with your friends and people, and participating in NGOs that you find that may be interesting, and public events and marches if you wish to, but you don't need to go that far if you don't want. But being aware of these issues and sharing your concerns, and not only with your friends and other students, but you can also write to your representatives in the Congress or in the Japanese Diet and so on. It's their job, you know, representatives in the legislature, it's their job to listen to the opinions of the people.
Yeah, I personally want to say that it is very important for, you know, you guys, really young guys, to know about those things. And I think it's very important. I mean, it is difficult for a lot of people, a lot of Americans, a lot of Japanese people to know about these issues because, like, they don't know any Muslims here or in the States even. And I think it's important to have, like, personal connections, or, you know, if difficult, maybe you can just, you know, talk about it online even. You know, it's, you know, you're the next generation. You have, like, tools that we don't even know of. And, like, you know, those things can make a completely big difference. Thank you.
Can I just say something really quickly, because I'm a little bit disappointed that I need the mic. Oh, sorry. I'm a little disappointed that people are feeling really negative. And I think that, you know, everybody can start with the point of learn more, educate the people around you, and do more. And I think it doesn't matter where you're from, but the first point, we need to educate ourselves. And then with the people we know, whether at school, where we work, different groups we belong to, educate those people. But that doesn't change anything. Sorry. We need to actually be active citizens. It doesn't matter where we're from. I think it's nice to write to Congress. I don't think that's going to have a big impact in Japan. But use social media, use the tools you have access to reach out to the friends around you, educate them. There's all of these different human rights organizations here in Japan. Human Rights Now, Japanese organization working on human rights. They're not going to make it an agenda item unless they feel that people think it's important. Human Rights Watch, an international organization, they have an office here in Japan. It's not going to be an agenda item for them here unless they feel it's an important issue for people here in Japan. Sorry, activist background. My standpoint is a little bit different, not very passive. I think that without the active part on our sides, nothing is going to change. And I think it's more than just, excuse me, I'll be more relaxed. It's more than just thinking about this as a Muslim issue. This is not a Muslim issue. If we take it to the human rights issue, there's so many entry points for everyone. It's an interfaith issue. Is it a Japanese, non-Japanese issue? Is this a reacting to fascism issue? Take whatever angle you want, what you're interested in. There is an entry point for every person to do something, and that's where your pessimism will end. Sorry.
But I think the pessimism
is based on being passive and thinking that we don't control the media and we don't
control the government. I don't feel passive. Thank you. That's great. I appreciate that. Appreciate that comment. First of all, I want to thank the panelists for a really interesting presentation with excellent content. Also want to thank Tina for all her work in putting this together. A couple of announcements. The third and final panel in this series is coming up on April 5th, and that's Viva la Revolucion, New Millennial Political Protest, and that's going to be on April 5th. Our institute does almost 40 lectures a year. We have an event coming up this coming Wednesday in which the dean of the Harvard Divinity School is going to talk about Trump and his effect on American politics. We are a nonprofit organization, but we do incur some expenses, so if you want to make a donation, that'd be much appreciated. Please make sure you drop off your Meishi so we can put you on the mailing list, and we hope to see you here again. Thanks.